Good evening and welcome. My name is Deborah Clemens. I'm the Assistant Director of Public and Academic Programs here at the RISD Museum. As we settle in, please note the location of your nearest emergency exit. On either side of the stage, toward the back of the auditorium at the top of the stairs, and the entrance to which you arrived. To formally begin the program, please welcome to the podium the President of the Rhode Island School of Design, Roseanne Summerson.
Thank you, Deb, and welcome to students and faculty, alumni, community members, members of the Silver family, and friends of Gail Silver. This lecture series honoring Gail Silver is really a high point each year, something we look forward to with great anticipation, which really starts in the summer and continues well into this part of the fall semester every year. And I'm honored to extend a warm welcome to this year's distinguished Gail Silver Memorial Lecturer, the great Shazia Sikander, a RISD alumna and this year's Kirloskar Visiting Scholar in the Painting Department. So we have the great fortune of having Shazia in residence throughout the year for us this year. Our museum director, John Smith, will give a more thorough introduction shortly, but on behalf of the entire RISD community, let me be the first to tell you how delighted and honored we are that you've come back to join the RISD community and that you'll also be in residence here for part of the year. Our mission, as many of you know, is built around a commitment to making lasting global contributions. The very fabric of our identity as an institution, in fact, has always been defined by this. And today, with alumni in 92 countries, which is almost half the countries of the world, which is really remarkable, our members of the community are global, and our intellectual and creative influences come from more geographic, social, and cultural sites than ever before. Our demographics are changing, but more importantly, who we are and what we mean when we say we is changing as well. We are in a period of wonderful, positive growth. Our remarkable museum is one of the core elements of this growth, extending and articulating our diverse institutional identity with objects and works of art spanning more than 4,000 years and from all corners of the globe. Tonight's lecture honors the spirit of Gail Silver, a longtime docent at the RISD Museum who, long before it was popular to do so, worked hard to bring attention to the contributions of underrepresented artists to American art. Through this work, which influenced not only RISD, but also the local community, Gail's work helped create a more inclusive and therefore more meaningful museum experience. I am so proud that Gail's work helped define who we are as an institution then, and I'm also proud that we are keeping this spirit alive and building from a place of strength as we head into the future. Our guest tonight, Shazia Sikander, is such a wonderful model for us and for our students. Through her work, she shows us all how to create a socially engaged, globally conscious artistic practice rooted in research and intellectual rigor. Shazia examines the present through the lens of symbols, artistic traditions of practice, mythologies, and histories that stem from diverse cultural traditions, including, but certainly not limited to, the Indo-Persian influences of her native Pakistan. However, we never sense in Shazia's work that her references are fixed to past traditions or fantasies of cultural purity. Rather, we see cultural tropes that embrace historical moments and transitions, that cross migrations and diasporas, and that incorporate a variety of artistic idioms and mediums, raising complex questions at each point along the way. Shazia's work is a highly refined example of what we at RISD call critical making. It is creative practice based on rigorous critical inquiry into complex, shifting realities of power and human identity in a global post-colonial world. If I may speak personally for a moment, I had the great pleasure of viewing Shazia's exquisite recent solo show, Apparatus of Power, at the Asia Society in Hong Kong, A special treat that, to my delight, Shazia was there completely unexpectedly when I arrived and provided a personal tour through the exhibition, which was such a memorable experience. I personally find her work to be poignant and stunningly beautiful in image, concept, and execution. I will invite John Smith to speak more about Shazia and her work in a moment, but let me just say how thrilled I am to be able to welcome you back to RISD, Shazia. We all feel so fortunate to have you here. Thank you. And it is now my pleasure to introduce John Smith, our museum director, who will do a more formal introduction. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, President Summerson, and welcome to everyone gathered here this evening for the 40th annual Gail Silver Memorial Lecture. Each year, this event provides the occasion for us to remember and celebrate Gail Silver's legacy and her love of art, education, community, and the RISD Museum. During her lifetime, Mrs. Silver was a great friend of the museum and a dedicated believer that art can transform lives and communities, a belief rooted in the many years that she served as a docent, an educator, and a board member at the RISD Museum. She not only led countless tours for school groups within the museum galleries, but she really was something of an art missionary, traveling throughout the region, giving talks and lectures to audiences of all ages. And all of us at the museum and throughout the community remain grateful and indebted to Mrs. Silver and her family, particularly her children, Paul, June, and Susan, for their lasting gifts to Providence and their continuing support of these lectures. So please join me in thanking the Silver family. Over the years, the Gail Silver Lecture has provided a platform for the RISD Museum to welcome leading thinkers, artists, and historians to the Providence community, and this evening is certainly no exception. Shazia Sikander was born in Lahore, Pakistan in 1969 and studied at the National College of Arts in Lahore, where she received her BFA in 1992 with an emphasis on the Indo-Persian tradition of miniature painting. In 1993, she enrolled in the MFA program at RISD, graduating in 1995. Shazia's mastery of the centuries-old tradition of miniature painting as a point of departure for exploring contemporary cultural and social issues came at a time when many artists were focused on an identity-based practice, and she quickly embarked on what can only be considered a meteoric rise in the international art world in the mid to late 1990s, highlighted by important solo exhibitions at the Renaissance Society in Chicago in 1998, the Smithsonian's Hirshhorn Museum in 1999, and the Whitney Museum in 2000. Since that time, interest in Shazia's work has continued to grow, and she has been included in dozens of solo and group exhibitions in museums and galleries throughout the world. Simultaneously, her work has expanded beyond painting and drawing to include video, animation, sculpture, performance, and installations, as well as collaborations with other visual artists, poets, and musicians. Currently, her exhibition entitled Ecstasy is Sublime, Heart as Vector, is on view at the National Museum of Contemporary Art in Rome, and she has also recently completed a major commission at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, as well as a spectacular work of public sculpture for the campus of Princeton University. I'm also thrilled to share that in spring of 2018, the RISD Museum will collaborate with Shazia to mount a show of her work here in Providence. Among her many awards is the Asia Society Award for Significant Contribution to Contemporary Art in 2015, the Medal of Art conferred by the U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton in 2012, and the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation Achievement, or the Genius Award, in 2006. Shazia's work is represented in dozens of collections of major museums throughout the world, including the RISD Museum. And I'm happy to announce that I learned from Shazia earlier this week that she's facilitated a gift of a recent portfolio of etchings that will come as a gift from Pace Editions to the RISD Museum later this year, which we're thrilled to be able to add that really important work to our collection. This evening, our two presidential candidates meet for their final debate. As we consider the upcoming election and all that it represents for our country and the world, I wanted to end my introduction with a brief paragraph that I pulled from a longer essay that Shazia wrote earlier this year and was published in the Los Angeles Times this spring. For me, cultivating imagination and fostering empathy started in childhood. Learning how to coexist begins with understanding and celebrating all our identities, pluralities, and intersections. Art and literature have played significant roles in shaping my understanding of differences and similarities. Creativity is essential for both young and adult, but it's adults who must address and correct the forces of ignorance, fear, and misplaced rage. So please join me in welcoming Shazia Sakai.
Good evening, and thank you so much, everybody, for coming. Thank you, John. To be giving this year's Gail Silver Memorial Lecture is yet another honor RISD has extended to me. It is overwhelming to reflect the early years as a student here, as there are endless aspects, anecdotes, various epiphanies that rush for expression. My academic year at RISD, the entire career was one of extreme strides, not just in classes, but also in cultural interpretation and understanding. The degree of possibility that I saw before me upon arriving in this country was made reality at this school as one encounter after another proved to accommodate my growth. From the freedoms I enjoyed in the studios to the receptive faculty and supportive community, this place was where I could ask, receive, and contribute. I'm not sure such an experience would or could have occurred elsewhere. There are so many people to thank personally that it is impossible to go through the list at this time. Many of you are here and many perhaps watching, and I would like to take this opportunity to say that creativity has no national, racial, or religious boundaries. It is the power of imagination that fosters new discourse and creates new frontiers. Imagination is wondrous. It cannot be contained, and it cannot be defined. With imagination comes humility and inventiveness. To all the young students watching and listening, I want to emphasize that feeding one's imagination is an ongoing task, a journey of curiosity and discovery that can never stop. There is no arrival. It is a process, and perhaps the most significant player in it is time. Critical thinking, creativity, collaboration are the three tenets on which I have built my entire understanding of being an artist, a narrative that continues to investigate discourse styles, verbal and poetic language, migration patterns, cultural quarantine, interaction, and ultimately human identity. Imagination and intuition inform my process, and words validate my experience. Art, at times, a solitary practice, is sustained by the desire to connect and communicate. The pendulum between conformity and freedom, craft and culture, fragility of emotion and tenacity of control. Art engages the heart, and the heart functions as a filter for truth. Within the work of art, the elasticity of the form is its ability to remain relevant over its various iterations within geographical, historical, socio-political, cultural, gendered, and psychological transformations. I would like to begin by sharing some current projects, as it is where my focus is, and much of this work is on view, or will be very soon. I hope many of you will also be able to see this work in person. The Philadelphia Museum of Art is home to one of the finest collections of South Asian art in the US, spanning from the 2nd century BC to the present. The South Asian galleries have been reorganized after 40 years, and they have opened this month. I am proud to say I am the only living artist in the galleries currently. History and storytelling feature prominently in my work, calling into question issues around redaction, perception of authority, and independence. Disruption as Rapture is a video animation set to an original score that derives its inspiration from the 18th century Gulshan-e-Ishq manuscript in Philadelphia Museum's permanent collection. Using the Gulshan-e-Ishq as a point of departure, Disruption as Rapture focuses on exploring the multiplicity of meaning within the manuscript to engage the multiple narratives that are housed within it. It was important for me to keep in mind the ethos of the work from within its historical and socio-political period. The Rose Garden of Love, Gulshan-e-Ishq, was written in 1657 to 58 by Nusrati, court poet to Sultan Ali Adil Shah II of Bijapur. The poem is also written in Deccani Urdu and Persian Naqsh script, the language of the Muslim elite in South Central India, a North Indian Hindu love story recast as a Sufi tale for an Islamic court. The religious and cultural plurality at play is an important lens in time. The poet recounts a tale of connection, separation, longing, and the story emerges as a metaphor for a soul's search for and connection with the divine. The plurality that exists in this manuscript, Hindu and Sufi, metaphor and message, is explored through a collaborative process with my long-term animator Patrick O'Rourke, composer Diyan, and vocalist Ali Sethi, who together view their work as a respectful disruption of traditional motifs. I'm going to show the animation. Thank you.
लागी लगन तो से रैन अंधेरी डराए जीरा मोरा लरजे अबके चैन न आए।
So the I'm going to show several animations just to share how I work through a different variety of forms and how they sort of alter between different formats and mediums. So I work in a variety of mediums and I seek a multivalent and interdisciplinary approach to process. I also think my work is deeply connected to the act of drawing. Drawing is my thinking tool. It functions like a libretto in my work. The work here is an older work. When I first started to do animation in 2001, this work is called Spin, and a recurring form, one of many that I've developed as part of my visual language, is a silhouette of the hair worn by a female worshiper of Krishna known as Gopi. This is at the forefront in this particular work. What happens here is that the figure sheds, the hair sheds its reference to its origin, to gender, and when isolated and multiplied, turns into bats, floating helmets, or even abstract forms. Early in my practice, I began developing a personal vocabulary, an alphabet of sorts in which forms could serve as stock figures and no longer had to hold on to their original meaning. Digitizing captured my imagination as a stand-in for vector. Space, velocity, magnitude, direction, all are essential for the movement and projection of my drawings. In developing a parallel between the drawn and the digital, both of which have infinite space, I wanted to collapse the boundaries between organic and synthetic drawing. Drawing on paper, as witnessed in the folios of the Gulshan-e-Ishq manuscript, has an aspect of infinity in that it doesn't end at the edge of the sheet, but hints at a narrative continuing beyond. This particular idea has always been at the core of my dismantling traditional miniature paintings. The intent is to transform motifs in order to cultivate new associations for trenchant historical symbols, and this way I can service more than one vantage point. So here, this was an animation which I'm going to show also. It's made out of the gopi hair. This was showing at Frieze a week ago. The Golden Singing Suns. The single unit of the gopi hair silhouette has tremendous possibilities. When reproduced in the millions, the hair silhouette operate as a pulsating mass of movement that oscillates between several representations, such as the sun, spheres, or swarms. What is important is the kinetic thrust, the enormous energy charge at the interface with this undulating movement. It's simultaneously tangible, a rigid icon, and elusive, constantly morphing and altering. Powerful and subliminal, the beauty of the gopi particles is that they can operate as both the unhinged and the durable, functioning as a force, an engine for survival. As in most of my work, the emphasis also here is on flux. So you can see the work was created through drawings. Drawings vary, some are large scale, some are detailed, some are small, but they are all scanned at various stages and then they get altered through the use of movement.
Thank you.
Here you see the gopis in Times Square installation that I did last year. And here the piece was called Gopi Contagion. So again, in Gopi Contagion, there is no direct reference to the female figure of the gopi other than its hair silhouette. The singular form, when digitized thousands of times and choreographed to move like birds, bats, or insects, becomes a swarm, reaches self-organized criticality, and then redistributes visually and experientially. Disruption as a means of exploration is a consistent element in my experimental strategy. The notion is to unhinge so that the female account or narrative is freed to create its own history and empower its own narrative. The approach creates suggested endless possibilities for motifs once divorced from their prescribed representations. Refusing fixity, the form's state of flux and symbolic oscillation propel it into new life. Its instability is its subliminal state. The first experiments in separating the hair from its source were also experiments in engaging difference, in the sense that the hair silhouettes were kept intact. The intent to imbue them with new meaning was not at the expense of altering their original character. It was imperative that they retained their distinct shape and form and yet cast themselves in continuously evolving iterations. Gopi Contagion was playing on all the major billboards for probably five blocks from the 43rd to 47th streets on Broadway. A collaboration with the Times Square Arts Alliance. It also came about as I often walk everywhere in New York City, and I have a studio in Times Square. But at night, this work was happening every night for an entire month at midnight, a few minutes at that time. So I always thought that that hour was very critical. That's when the swarms descended and they were omnipresent. Next, I'm going to share another current work. Actually, the work has not yet opened. It will be opening soon, in a few weeks. And it's my first foray into glass. This work is in progress. It opens at the Princeton University. It's a 60-plus foot mosaic and a 25-foot luminous, multi-layered glass painting. The works are site-specific, and they will be permanently installed at the Economics Department building at Princeton. Here you can see, this is from the last several weeks, where I've been installing the work with the team. The people that I worked with are based in Munich, where the glass mosaic was done. So even for this project, the root of it was really held in drawing. So I created new compositions, keeping in mind the context of both the economics and the international departments. The resulting visual lexicon has been used as a springboard to explore the dynamics of a material like glass, allowing the work to find new iterations, as well as addressing the work's issue of longevity for site-specific residents. So you can see here, it's the length, it's the height of the building, it's about 70 feet. And all of it was based on drawings that I did. So the drawings were scaled up, and then they were used as templates for the mosaic. The focus on economics is of relevance to the visual content of this work. Over the past 4 years, I have been exploring the histories that have informed our modern economy. The British East India Company had a lasting impact on strategies of corporate operations. I'm interested in the legacy of the colonial economy and how we still exist in similar economic operations to what existed in the 17th century. So this work is born out of a body of work. So I usually straddle several different directions of work, but most of it is informed with the same sort of similar thinking. The thrust of thinking is in the same direction. So recent and new work explores the global economy by considering the waterways, aerial and aquatic routes, the movement of bodies and objects in land, sea, or air that circulate. I'm interested in the mechanisms that execute such exchanges, such as trade, airplanes, boats, cars, and foot traffic. Outside of the narrative, the work explores and distorts economies of scale to play with light and shadow, as well as the idea of the atrium and forum as the meeting place in the building. You can see all of this was done directly. The painting was done directly on glass, and it was embedded in the glass. And there are several layers of glass. So it's, for me, it was very similar to drawing, and also the use of materials such as ink and water-based material that I work with that allow a certain play with opacity and transparency, and I was able to achieve that in a medium like glass. So I began working in animation in 2001, and in high definition animation in 2010, with the last post and Parallax, another major work, which was done in 2013. The last post was done in 2010, and both to develop my ideas about the colonial legacy of corporate enterprises and circulation of objects, of ideas, and within the larger geopolitical context. So the last post dealt with the company man, the British official who came to South Asia. Parallax addresses the Strait of Hormuz. So this, then I had a recent exhibition at the Asia Society in Hong Kong, and that particular architecture of the space and its history was that propelled me to explore the context for the show. It was built by the British Army in the mid-19th century for explosives and ammunition production and storage, the former explosives magazine compound at the old Victoria Barracks, and it still is among the very few still existent today. So the design of the space reflects functional practicality in that the vaulted ceilings could draw the force of an explosion vertically instead of laterally, and their thick granite walls kept the interior humid, a necessity for the ammunition. That's the site where all the work was exhibited. The site served as housing for British soldiers between 1843 and 1846 before it was transformed into a production and processing plant for artillery. The protagonist in my work, the East India Company man, is precisely the official who would have once lived here. The last post deals with the history of colonial struggle and international trade in India. So a part of a satellite exhibition was also held at the Maritime Museum in Hong Kong. I am interested in movement. Movement that can be literal, as in the physical crossing of geographical borders by bodies, species, commodities, resources, and it can also be symbolic, as borders have the capacity to function as abstract concepts that contribute, often in very real and material ways, to the sense of belonging or exclusion from a geographically determined space. So these are the drawings that, you know, led to the animation itself, and here some more stills. It was first produced for the Rock Bund Museum in Shanghai for an exhibition curated by Hu Hanru, and that was that marked my first collaborative work with the composer Du Yan. Then we went on to create another large-scale work, a three-channel, very sort of far more ambitious work that took more than a year for me to create. It's titled Parallax, and Parallax was created in 2013 for the Sharjah Art Biennial. Parallax also examines mechanisms of power and ideas of conflict and tension over the control of strategically desired geography, a place where 1/5 of world's total oil passes. It's a multi-channel video work composed from hundreds of small drawings that have been digitally animated. It deals with the history of maritime trade in the Strait of Hormuz, particularly the fraught history of imperial control. I came across the image of a multi-valved oil well in British Petroleum magazine. So just to share how ideas evolve and how research guides one's evolvement of imagery and forms. So I was surprised to see it called a Christmas tree. To me, it did not resemble a Christmas tree from anywhere. And I thought that its name was more a reference to its gift-bearing abilities. So I decided to build on this idea and create a fully embellished tree from the valves and spools with the chains functioning as garlands. Images specific to the site include my drawings of topographic maps of the Strait of Hormuz, the historic fort of Ras Al Khaimah, aerial views of the region, historic oil apparatuses, all from the 1960s. Just as a point of reference, this particular drawing called the Wall States, when I was making this work, I was recording the various stages of this painting for the purpose of exploring movement. Painting kept changing dramatically over the course of its making. The map, for example, of the US emerged organically towards the end of the painting. Initially, I was pursuing an idea of a proverbial fort, and that evolved into the painting into the Dayan Fort in Ras Al Khaimah, symbolic of the battles between the Emirates and the English. The Al Qasimis operating from Ras Al Khaimah and Sharjah were a significant maritime force in the 18th century that lost to the British in the Battle of Ras Al Khaimah of 1809. Soon after, maritime treaties were imposed to end the alleged piracy. I have been using poetry as a means of agency via local poets for scores, mostly composed by Du Yan. Here too, the poets that I met were through the Poetry House in Sharjah, and the collaboration that ensued was pretty much organic. There is a close relationship between prose and poetry in my work, which functions as a parallel to the recitation and delivery in the score. Improvisation is also a trait both the composer and myself share. I would like to show a clip of this work also.
جلفار يا جلفار أمي مغرم وحواتي أكعبد السهاد لنا والها تسع عجاف قد أكلنا سنابلي وسلبنا من ناي الصدى الحالية والهاجس المزروع في رؤى الرؤى أدمى حموحي واستباح صوابي كل المواكب للكواكب سافر كل المواكب للكواكب سافرت إلا دروبي لا تزال جواكب أتصحر للرأي في عهد الندى ويلاه بل هم صادروا أفكاري قد هاجر الإبداع مكسور الخطى متلفتة نحو الأهالي شافية هادية أساطير الثقافة تشتكي وبدت أساطير الرواة رواسية
ترتاح عليها بعض الحوريات والموج المتردد يفتح أسداف الحب فلا لؤلؤ لا حلم ولا أمنيات والمقهى يعطفه قلق يبحث كان بجيب اللاطف عن آخر ورد كنت كتبته عن آخر ورد في زاوية المقهى أنت تركته خبأه اللاطف ذات عبير في عينيه وعلى طاولة السمت أغمض قهوته وأجل الإسرار على كفيه لم يفهم لغة الباب لم يكتب شيئا بعد تضع هناك يدين المقهى هل كان هنالك حق المقهى لأن الشارع لا يحمل بقهوة روحي وتمناك
وأتته تحمس للأماكن. لن أقول له كتبتك في قصيدة. وأتته تعجن غيمة خجلا وتسكن
البريد على أطراف أصابع
سهمت البريد
وعلى أنغام قصاصي دقائق ثواني.
أين مكتبك هكذا؟
فلا أعرف أين أخبئ إسارات زمان يتسارع.
So here, this is sort of a place where I'm looking back now at my very early work. So there's an uncanny similarity between the multi-channel, cinematic, digital, collaborative work and my very first painting, the scroll painting, which I did in 1989 to 90. And also to correct the record, I graduated in 1991 from the National College of Arts in Lahore, Pakistan. Here, when I juxtapose these works, for me, I'm thinking that both were departures in terms of form and scale. The scroll painting at that time in the late 80s was a game changer within the field of contemporary miniature painting. Instead of depicting what was the norm then, a contemporary version of a traditional ritual, the scroll explored the impact of youth, the flux of identity, the narrative as a moving image, and the picture plane as an infinite space. Even at that time, I was looking at narrative structures in film and cinema when I was laying out the conceptual foundation for the scroll. The scroll merges multiple narratives into a single frame. Parallax employs an interdisciplinary thrust to juxtapose poetry, painting, and animation to broadcast a heightened sensorial experience. Now, these are some drawings like from late 80s. These are large-scale collage works that I was doing in the late 80s. For me, art is not just an impulse to make aesthetically pleasing objects. It has, from the very beginning, been an instinct to think and imagine. I grew up Muslim in Pakistan, went to an all-girls Catholic convent school, then studied literature, math, that both continue to influence my art. Like many others of my generation, growing up in Pakistan in the 1980s was a deeply conflicting experience. Soviet-Afghan war was creating new social, political, and cultural ruptures in Pakistan. Religion was steadily becoming institutionalized. The Hudud ordinances, which limited women's rights, loomed large. Co-education dissipated. Religious tolerance diminished. It was around this time that I started questioning my calling. It was precisely the mindless malaise injected and perpetuated by the Ziaul-Huq's dictatorial regime that pushed me as a young woman into the direction of art. I have examined miniature painting for almost three decades and see my role as primarily investigative. Miniature paintings, audacious, bold lines, inventive perspective, unparalleled range and juxtaposition of color hold infinite worlds of possibilities within its expression. My first visual encounter with miniature painting was with its facsimile while perusing a handful of Western museums' exhibition catalogs in the mid-80s. There were no real miniatures to look at. The bulk of information was through printed images from Western institutions where many of the works reside. When I joined the National College of Arts in 1987, I was in an intuitive mode, seeking what would speak to me. I had no predetermined ideas or intent. the miniature painting department at the National College of Arts in Lahore at that time was virtually empty. This is 1986-87. And several people advised me not to enter the department because traditional work would not allow much room for creative exploration. In general, in the painting department, there was a prevalent emphasis on modernism, and various iterations of abstract expressionism were around. Devotion to tradition arrested my attention, but it didn't limit me. This is work that has become such a signature image of mine, and this was done here at RISD. I think when I was seeking my own sense of connection to history in the deeply uncertain times of the 80s, it wasn't so much that miniature painting sparked my passion, but rather I knew the medium had untapped potential to be a contending platform within the contemporary art world. During this period, you know, the Euro-American canon dominated the field of painting around the globe. The whole process of locating one's relationship to tradition is not about copying or appropriating, but how to actually regurgitate to own. How does that ownership occur? What is originality? What is creativity? What is imagination? How does one create something anew? Imaginative possibilities abound within the world itself, not just within the realm of the mind. The form as something alive and in relationship to its space, technique, and time, the dynamism of form interests me deeply. I was very influenced by Eva Hesse's work, like the one here on the left. Also, Anna Mandietta. I dislocated framing devices to open up the narratives of gender and identity. Artists like Eva Hesse, writers like Fatima Mernissi, Ismet Çağatay, all were useful. Examining Hesse's work offered a perspective from a female artist's interventions into minimalism. It allowed me to trace my own relationship with the male-dominated miniature painting field. My work started reflecting an evocative engagement with feminism and sexuality. I also became interested in cultural semiotics within religious representations, as well as juxtaposing anti-classical impulses in Western art, such as mannerism, with a variety of outsider aesthetics. This particular series called Monsters, Midgets to Monsters, was an indirect arrival to the human form. I was subverting the dead decorative arts in books on Islamic art by infusing their form and physicality with a perceived lurking vitality. Looking at the metal or ceramics not as objects but as things that come to life, a stance I recognized within the Safavids in their strategies to bring animate and inanimate representations together. In addition, layering strategy to juxtapose overlaps of culture, art, history, social commentary continued in my process. My digital work now is a natural progression of my murals and installation works that I started to develop in the 1990s also. Many of these drawings were fodder for large-scale works, so I was interested in shifting the scale to see how a small form could exist, how whether it would become confrontational, whether it would attain a different value once it left the space of paper. This is not the time when I started to do animation, but I feel like the animation was a natural extension to this direction. Uh, These are images from my current exhibition up at Maxi Museum in Rome. This is a very early drawing, a wall drawing done at the Hirshhorn Museum in 1999. I began experimenting with the wall and floor as a drawing surface here at the MFA, as an MFA student at the Rhode Island School of Design in 1993. Later, throughout the 90s, I did plenty of wall drawings in different places like the Yorba Buena in San Francisco, the Drawing Center in New York City, and this is from the previous one was from Icon Gallery in Birmingham, and this is the MCA in Sydney. I was, from wall drawings, I started to add depth by engaging paper directly onto the wall. And then these two-dimensional surfaces suddenly became theatrical. Excuse me. The ephemeral installations were made out of multiple sheets of translucent paper. This particular work was done in Paris, and it was on a curved wall. So it kind of reminds me of the way the multi-channel animations now are sort of very experiential and immersive, and the walls are almost like in a circular manner, so you can sit inside, and they have gone up to 28 meters, so at a very large scale. So here also, I think the idea was that there were no boundaries, there were no borders, the space was infinite. And at the same time, there is an underlying play with labor, with time, with ephemerality. The paper is very tenacious, it's very delicate, and it's also not very precious. So by layering so much of that paper, I was almost extending paper as the medium, as the language in this work. And this was done at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Tokyo. So the idea of writing, of mark making, and of thinking, drawing through thinking, and usage of the scroll as a format was extended into these drawings. This brings me to another very pivotal work called Many Faces of Islam. This was done in 1999. It was published in 1999 in New York Times Magazine, but I was working on it for many years before that. So the oscillation of miniature painting between illustration and illumination has also served as a significant format. I explored the illuminated manuscript as a device for political proposition, as in the Many Faces of Islam, which first appeared in the September 19th, 1999, New York Times Magazine, highlighting its function as a vehicle for historical narrative with a political bent by looking at the interface of American policy in Islamic countries. So this work was, of course, part of a project called Imagining the Millennium by Living Artists. And because, you know, this is done a year ahead of September 11, 2001, it became regarded as a prescient work in the wake of September 11th. This brings me to another familiar trope in my work, the red, white, and blue, which has myriad possibilities within its symbolic restrictions, the fluttering arms, the spinning arms, the broken forearms, the clenched hands are all iterations of struggle, fear, terror, might, control, loss of power, fate, and they are borrowed from a multitude of references. One is the Vishvarupa image with multiple arms issuing from a single elbow like a whirligig. The rapid movement allows it to move, but denies it the ability to fly, a fluttering of sorts. When the arms are separated, their dispersed state allows them to freely move around in the atmosphere. The notion of the one containing many is a familiar universal theme of divinity. Like the gopi hair silhouette, the arm motif has creative potential in that it can exist as a unit that is able to expand and multiply, transforming its meaning. Here, the red, white, blue is a juxtaposition. The title is Utopia. The stylized Safavid angels atop the US flag via Jasper Johns mark an encounter between two different epistemologies of symbolism. The reductive aspect of Jasper Johns' use of flag takes on an uneasy sentimentality in the presence of the ethereal Persian angels. In my own self-portrait, the red, white, blue arms represent the hyphenated American identity linked to the subliminal androgynous idea of the self. I have also used, there's a lot of reference to writing, there are lots of authors, literature plays a significant role in my work, but I also extended into the work itself. So the usage and reference of text in the work is multifold, from interest in textual artifacts, historical writing, fiction, lyrical expression, terseness, wit, from poetic traditions. I engage text with no particular allegiance. What captures my imagination about writing is its inherent ability to redact. Redaction becomes a pertinent issue, especially in terms of how history is constantly being rewritten in both cultural and political spheres. Words I read are thoughts I carry. Writing is fundamental, in a way, to my practice. When I read words that inspire me, the relationship cast with the experience itself is precise and tactile. Visual experience is often a sensorial turmoil. When I'm moved by a work of art or by nature, I usually respond by writing about the experience. The process of writing allows me to reflect, a magical thinking of sorts. It will elicit multiple responses over an undetermined period of time. It is that space of interiority and of unknown measure that piques my curiosity. Out of the amalgamation of visual memory, chaos of experience, and the influence of the literary comes the amorphous creativity through the act of drawing. I think I'm going to end here so that there's time for us to engage. And also, I think this is a very appropriate a point to stop here. This is a project I did with the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum in 2009, and using a lot of their Jacquard collection. This particular one interested me because it declared that it was the facsimile of the copy of the original, and it's the Declaration, the Signatures of Independence from the Declaration of Independence. And I ended up creating a work in response to that, which I don't have here, but which basically was a further contamination on the idea of authority. And in there, I was playing with this idea that time is the nemesis to authority. Thank you very much, everybody.